Of the challenges that will face the new president, the growing concerns of the world's peoples at the UN, expressed by world leaders and non-governmental organizations represented by citizens, experts, and by celebrities, Ted Turner and supermodel of the 80s, Christy Brinkley, who helped draw wider attention to nuclear issues. And finally, what the two major American presidential candidates say they will do about the continuing global threat of the bomb. Since the advent of the atomic age with the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the world's peoples have sought the elimination of nuclear weapons. To that end, the member states of the United Nations signed the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty.
Yet still, there are thousands of nuclear weapons and no final agreement on their abolition. The 2005 Non-Proliferation Treaty Review failed to reach a consensus.
And later at the United Nations 2005 summit, the United States ruled nuclear disarmament off the agenda. Secretary General Kofi Annan expressed frustration and concern.
The big item missing is non-proliferation and disarmament. This is a real disgrace. We have failed twice this year. We failed at the NPT and we failed now. And I hope the leaders will see this as a real signal for them to pick up the ashes and really show leadership on this important issue when we are all concerned about weapons and of mass destruction and possibility that they may even get into the wrong hands.
In a report to the United Nations in June 2006, former UN weapons inspector Hans Blix, best remembered for predicting 4 years earlier that no nuclear weapons would be found in Iraq, now addresses a larger global concern. As chairman of a 15-member independent international commission of experts on the threat of weapons of mass destruction, Blix presents Weapons of Terror, the report of their sweeping and comprehensive recommendations for creating a world free of weapons of mass destruction. Among their recommendations, a call for a special UN summit on disarmament.
There should be another world summit after due and long thorough preparations in order to make up for the failure of last year's summit to even to accept any lines about disarmament and non-proliferation and arms control.
Blix was referring to the UN failures in 2005 of both the Non-Proliferation Treaty Conference, the NPT, and later the World Summit, when nuclear weapons nations refused even to discuss their earlier NPT agreements to disarm. Non-nuclear weapons nations complained of betrayal.
I think one can sense a frustration on both sides of the line in the Non-Proliferation Treaty. That treaty is, after all, a bargain in which the non-nuclear weapon states say that they will not acquire nuclear weapons, and the nuclear weapon states promise that they will negotiate towards disarmament. It was confirmed in the year 2000, but after the year 2000, we heard at the conference in 2005 that these things were from a different era. So I think there was this feeling of, there was a feeling among the non-nuclear weapon states that they were being tricked into having given a consensus.
This program reports on what happened at the UN conference in 2005, its implications, and what the world's peoples, mayors, and governments are now doing about it. The United Nations meets only once every 5 years to review the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, the treaty to get rid of nuclear weapons. The next review will not be until 2010. The treaty, signed in 1970, states in the crucial Clause 6, parties to the Non-Proliferation Treaty undertake to pursue negotiations in good faith on effective measures relating to the cessation of the nuclear arms race at an early date, and to nuclear disarmament, and on a treaty on general and complete disarmament under strict and effective international control. As the world's nations were gathering at the UN to review the NPT, still the world's most important treaty, the people of the world were gathering calling for renewed commitment by nuclear nations to the complete abolition of nuclear weapons, as had been agreed to in 2000 at the United Nations Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty Review Conference. 40,000 strong, they came to New York Central Park in a rally led by a huge contingent from Japan,
The rally had gained urgency from reports that the United States was preparing to weaken or reject the NPT's requirements for nuclear disarmament. At the rally, an initiative by the world's mayors called the Mayors for Peace announced a call for complete nuclear disarmament by the year 2020. It was headed by the mayors of Hiroshima and Nagasaki.
They feel a special obligation, especially now as they see the threat of the actual use of nuclear weapons coming closer and closer, to do whatever they can to alert the world.
More than 1,000 mayors from cities around the world had joined the campaign, and more than 100 had come to the United Nations. And world citizens in their millions were signing petitions of support. At the United Nations, world citizens, represented by the NGOs, the non-governmental organizations, were preparing for the month-long NPT review conference amidst growing concerns that nuclear disarmament had stalled since the last review conference 5 years earlier. Nuclear powers are building new nuclear bombs and are planning for possible use. The American State Department declared, "It is our policy to continue to plan for contingencies and conceptually explore technical options that could maintain the credibility of our nuclear deterrent capability." The U.S. Nuclear Posture Review declares, "New nuclear capabilities must be developed to defeat emerging threats." And the American Nuclear Weapons Laboratories declared, "The abolition of nuclear weapons is an impractical dream in any foreseeable future." More recently, the Bush administration has requested $6.4 billion to maintain existing nuclear arsenals and develop new nuclear weapons. At the UN, the people and the experts spoke out.
I consider this to be the most important conference the United Nations has ever held. I think from what you've heard now, we are on the brink of annihilation. Russia and America are on hair trigger alert. Certain diplomats have told me, high diplomats, that they've thought we've never been closer to the annihilation of life on the planet. Please take this responsibility seriously, I beg you, as a physician representing global public health.
The shadow of the Cold War still hangs over the United Nations and the world. The governments of the two major nuclear powers, the United States and Russia, still have 30,000 nuclear bombs and keep 5,000 bombs ready to launch on hair trigger alert. Right now they stand, ready to aim in a matter of seconds on millions of people in cities around the world.
The danger facing the world today with respect to nuclear weapons is far greater than most political leaders and most military leaders, most civilian security experts really understand. If they were, they would not tolerate what's going on in the NPT conference today.
As U.S. Defense Secretary during the Kennedy years, Robert McNamara speaks on the nuclear threat with an authority unique to those who had to make critical decisions during the 13 days of the Cuban nuclear missile crisis.
Now, as we speak, the U.S. has deployed about 6,000 strategic nuclear warheads. And of the 6,000, 2,000 are on hair trigger alert, ready to launch on 15-minute warning by the decision of one man, the President of the United States. This is a very, very dangerous situation. And the Russians presumably have essentially the same number of warheads and the same procedures. If I were to characterize U.S. and NATO policies in one sentence, at the risk of appearing simplistic and provocative, I would say they're immoral, illegal, militarily unnecessary, very, very dangerous in terms of accidental or inadvertent use, and destructive of the non-proliferation regime that has served us so well for 40 years.
One of the non-governmental organizations most actively involved in nuclear disarmament is the Global Security Institute, founded by the late United States Senator Alan Cranston, a longtime advocate of nuclear weapons abolition. At a UN presentation of the Alan Cranston Peace Award to Mikhail Gorbachev and Ted Turner, the Global Security Institute President Jonathan Granoff set the vision.
Now, our grandparents did not have two icons of the modern age, the mushroom cloud and that beautiful picture of planet Earth from outer space. One represents fear. Science and technology run amok without proper constraint of law, morality, or reason. The other represents hope, a majestic gift from the Creator, where we simply must learn to live together, where we must find our common humanity, where we must learn to separate from ourselves that which separates us from one another.
I am still committed to the principle that was established in a document that was adopted and signed by me and President Reagan in the fall of 1985. At that time in Geneva, we stated that a nuclear war cannot be won and must never be fought. That a real solution to this problem is the radical reduction and ultimately the elimination of weapons of mass destruction. In this context, I would like to speak about the most important international law document in this regard, and that is the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. The main responsibility in reducing nuclear weapons is still on those nations that have their greatest holdings, the United States and Russia.
I just don't see how you can have a world where there's some nuclear weapons and some people don't have them and some do, and it seems to be that the only practical way is to get rid of all of them, everybody get rid of them.
At another UN Global Security Institute conference on nuclear disarmament, another celebrity, Christy Brinkley, draws attention to the popular television news cameras, and it is she who then draws their attention to nuclear disarmament.
It is an honor to speak here at the United Nations, the repository of much of humanity's hopes for a peaceful future. I feel that my country bears an enormous responsibility to change the course of how nuclear weapons are treated. Henry Kissinger, George Shultz, Sam Nunn, and William Perry expressed in the Wall Street Journal this January the need to reinvigorate our efforts to obtain a nuclear-free world. And I couldn't agree more with their conclusion.
The Wall Street editorial by Kissinger, Perry, Nunn, and Shultz warns against the growing dangers of nuclear proliferation and calls for taking nuclear weapons off Cold War hair trigger alert posture, ratification of a comprehensive test ban treaty, ending production of fissile material for nuclear bombs, and a recommitment to the vision of a world free of nuclear weapons. The proposals have been supported by Robert McNamara, Colin Powell, Madeleine Albright, James Baker, Zbigniew Brzezinski, and more than 70 former U.S. Secretaries of State and Defense and senior military leaders.
Here are just a few of the staggering facts and figures I learned. The cost alone is, well, it's unethical. Over $5.5 trillion spent on weapons already. And the U.S. continues to spend over $100 million a day to maintain these weapons. That's just the money. How can we calculate the cost of a human life or a sick child? I also learned that the triggering devices on today's weapons are about the size of the bombs dropped on Hiroshima, that over 30,000 remain in the world today, and that thousands of weapons remain on hair trigger alert, just as they were at the height of the Cold War, that pledges to negotiate their elimination are weakening as my country contemplates building new and usable nuclear weapons, that there remains a willingness to actually intentionally use these brutal weapons which kill millions of innocent people. It's just horrific.
At a United Nations news conference, the mayors added their voices, warning of the growing dangers and the need for more citizens' action.
We are here to promote our campaign, which has a nickname of 2020 Vision, but it is the emergency action to ban nuclear weapons. And it is timely because the review conference for the NPT is being held in the United Nations. Our mission is to have all nuclear weapons eliminated by the year 2020 and within the framework of the United Nations.
And I look to you to help us try to eradicate from this earth these most inhumane weapons of mass destruction that are capable of annihilating the entire human race in one split second.
Hopefully we can build a movement that does what, at least initially, this effort here in New York is set out to do, which is to begin the elimination of the threat of nuclear war and then hopefully provide additional support for peace throughout the world.
Thank you, sir.
One World Radio. How seriously do the mayors regard what is in effect the most immediate and pressing threat, which is the fact that even as we speak, 5,000 nuclear weapons of the United States and Russia are set on high alert, with their rockets fueled, their gyroscope navigators constantly whirring, ready for launch within 90 seconds in some cases. How seriously do the mayors regard this threat, and what sort of support are the mayors getting for both disarmament and de-alerting from the mayors of Russia and the United States?
The threat right now seems to be more from rogue nations, more from terrorist groups, which are more individualized rather than nations. But nonetheless, anytime you have a nuclear weapon sitting on a rocket ready to go, fired up as you've described it, I think it causes concern for the whole world.
There was enthusiastic support for the mayor's proposals among the NGOs when they spoke to the delegates.
Together with the mayors from whom you have already heard, we represent millions of people worldwide. Opinion polls show that these people want to live without the scourge of nuclear weapons, in a world where governments are mature enough to resolve conflicts with more effective, non-lethal methods. That is why we endorse the Mayor's Campaign 2020 Vision. This opening statement is a collective product of all NGOs participating in this conference. It sets out, simply, our reasons why we believe that nuclear weapons in today's world are of no use at all, to anyone, for any reason. The finger is still on that button. The Cold War is over, yet thousands of nuclear weapons remain on hair trigger alert in the US and Russia. These could go off by accident, as a result of human error, or through unauthorized use, killing millions.
In the conference halls of the UN, the nuclear powers, and particularly the United States, deliberately bogged down the conference in a debate over Iran's nuclear program, and avoided even a discussion of their own earlier commitments to disarmament. The United States and Russia repeatedly were cited for continuing to develop nuclear weapons and maintain policies for their possible use.
Russia is engaged in modernization and replacement of existing systems in accordance with an intention to rely on nuclear forces indefinitely. The United States spends about $40 billion annually on nuclear forces, more than the total military budget for almost every other country.
The NPT conference also drew some of the world's leading legal authorities, including the former World Court Justice Christopher Weeramantri of Sri Lanka, who had presided at the historic World Court hearings on the legality of nuclear weapons in 1996. Which had declared that nuclear weapons nations were required to bring to a conclusion complete nuclear disarmament.
You have spoken of the historic importance of the World Court opinion. What role do you see it playing, or how do you think it may be perceived historically?
I would say, and I hope I'm not exaggerating my sort of impression of this case, it is one of the most important decisions ever to come before any court of law at any time. Because what was being referred to the court was this most momentous question of the ability of human beings to destroy themselves and what curbs could be imposed upon them through law. So there was never a more important issue because, as most people would agree, the nuclear issue is probably the most important issue that faces humanity. There were 14 judges who sat. All 14 completely agreed on this proposition, that there was an obligation on all powers that possess nuclear weapons to take meaningful steps to reduce their arsenal. So there is there a considered statement by the International Court on the duties of nuclear powers. So you could say that they are in breach of a principle of law as formulated by the World Court.
In an earlier documentary in this series, we reported on the World Court hearings on the legality of nuclear weapons. This was the first case to be initiated not by governments, but by NGOs, the non-governmental organizations, the people. Here is... In 1996, part of that program.
I want to record at the outset New Zealand's outrage at the resumption of French nuclear testing in our region of the world. South Pacific countries have had to put up with nuclear testing for far too long. The international community must turn up the pressure on nuclear weapons. Simply put, the world must now be rid of them.
Can intelligence have emerged in 15 billion years only to be eliminated in a few minutes?
Our Prime Minister announced last week that we would establish a group of knowledgeable, imaginative, and distinguished individuals from around the world to produce a report on how to achieve a nuclear weapons-free world as soon as possible, outlining the practical steps that would need to be taken to achieve that goal.
For the first time in its history, the court received petitions from non-governmental organizations, the NGOs, the people. More than 3 million petitions calling on the court to declare nuclear weapons illegal had been signed by millions of world citizens and hundreds of world leaders, including Nobel Peace Prize winners the Dalai Lama, Mikhail Gorbachev, and Archbishop Tutu. Another Nobel Prize winner, physicist Joseph Rotblat, had been asked to prepare testimony for the court, marking the first time the court had received testimony from an expert witness. In the early 1940s, Rotblat had worked on the Manhattan Project that built the first bombs. Alone among the scientists, he resigned when it was learned that Hitler had no nuclear program that could build a bomb. Rotblat was widely condemned for his action at the time. He went on to join with Albert Einstein and Bertrand Russell in Pugwash, the international movement to abolish nuclear weapons. In 1995, he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for his work with Pugwash.
People don't realize that the nuclear war, which we've been writing about, terrible consequences of the war, but we never really thought that it may lead not just to perhaps millions of people dying, as we describe it now, but actually with the extinction of the human race. It is possible now. Family and other people suffering and so on. It's become possible. So if we really become a real danger to the continued existence of the human species. Now, the first step to prevent it is to remove the instrument which can lead to such a catastrophe. And this is the reason why our immediate objective is the elimination of nuclear weapons.
Although the hearings in The Hague lasted 2 weeks, the world's mainstream media virtually ignored the proceedings. An exception was the American television channel Court TV, which alone covered the proceedings in their entirety, with commentary and debate, including assertions by the U.S. State Department that U.S. possession and use of nuclear weapons was legal.
The international agreements on the subject not only do not prohibit nuclear weapons, but they clearly are proceeding on the premise that there are lawful uses and possession of nuclear weapons.
The Non-Proliferation Treaty says nothing about the lawful use. The Non-Proliferation Treaty takes the world as it is. We have a world in which a few states have nuclear weapons. We have a world in which all the other states would like to be rid of the damn things.
At the 2005 NPT review, the primacy of world law was much discussed.
We have got to generate a respect for international law. Now, international law, in my view, is one of the most precious possessions that result of the onward march of civilization. And if we respect it, and all powers, great and small, will obey international law. But if some powers disobey it, other powers are tempted to do likewise. And the more so if it is the powerful states that part of current education is, that children are not taught that they are going to be the citizens in when they grow up, not a, I believe, a very defective part disobey it and disregard it. This state or that, but of the world community, of planet Earth, of which we are all fellow inhabitants.
At the 2005 NPT review conference, the World Court opinion was widely quoted.
Give it more respect, everybody will respect it.
Among those citing the World Court were representatives of a large contingent of teenagers representing the youth of the world.
The highest judicial institution on the international level, the International Court of Justice in The Hague, declared in 1996 that there is a binding obligation to disarm and abolish nuclear weapons enshrined in international law. If you fail to take concrete steps towards a nuclear weapon-free world, how will you answer for burdening us with such a horrifying menace? You are charged with making this decision. If you fail to act, how will you look into your own mirror? You must begin the elimination of all nuclear weapons. Do it for us, for your children, and for all following generations, as a vital step toward a more secure and peaceful future.
Alice Slater is founder of the international nuclear disarmament group Abolition Now.
And I'm really, as a U.S. citizen, ashamed of my government that they didn't use this opportunity of all the nations that we're here to work for further steps for disarmament and the cares we have about proliferation. We're not going to just take it laying down. I mean, this is like an outrage. We came here, we spent tens of thousands of dollars, you know, they've been here 4 weeks meeting, and you have this 800-pound gorilla, you know, refusing to even acknowledge other agreements that were made earlier. There's like a disrespect for the law. It's the Wild West right now.
Another NGO, the World Federalists, founded in 1947 by Albert Einstein, continue to call for nuclear disarmament.
And what we have to do is build a clear non-nuclear weapon world where the rule of law that people would feel would be fair, and that they'd get a fair shake from a world court deciding their disputes, and then it would be in every nation's interest to destroy their nuclear weapons, and I don't see why any nation would refuse to. But we've got to realize that these nuclear weapons are on the last stage of alert. You don't get a second chance. And if you realize that these guns, really loaded guns, are pointed at your head, you'll do something about it without waiting for it to take place.
It's more dangerous now than at the height of the Cold War. But the real, the big danger is the lack of awareness, the lack of interest, the lack of engagement. And it doesn't help, and it's not enough, if a bunch of diplomats, as myself, are very, very devoted and work very, very hard, if the general public does not hold their own politicians accountable for what we do and what we don't.
Other non-nuclear nations expressed their concerns. Japan. It is extremely regrettable that the conference has not been able to adopt a consensus document. The NPT, now more than ever, is of immense importance to international peace and security. New Zealand, Aotearoa. The NPT will be undermined unless current circumstances are rectified. Civil society must be afforded a greater role in that regard. Canada. If there is a silver lining in the otherwise dark cloud of this NPT review, it lies in the hope that leaders and citizens will be so concerned by its failure that they will mobilize behind prompt remedial action. Canada has emerged as a leading voice for world opinion in its call for nuclear disarmament. Canada's foremost figure in this movement is, and has been for many years, Senator Douglas Roche. Former Canadian disarmament minister and leader of international coalitions and networks calling for nuclear disarmament.
These include the Middle Powers Initiative and the New Agenda Coalition of Brazil, Egypt, Ireland, Mexico, New Zealand, South Africa, and Sweden.
Well, I led the Canadian delegation when I was ambassador to the NPT review of 1985, and I followed it very closely ever since, and I think the crisis that the NPT is passing through now is the worst. The entry into the second nuclear age, by which the major nuclear weapons states are cementing their nuclear weapons into their military doctrines. This is a modernizing of nuclear weapons. It is acting as a spur to other countries. And the refusal of the nuclear weapon states to recognize that their contribution to the instability in the international situation is what is worsening the situation. They are acting irresponsibly in consideration of their obligations to world humanity. Any detonation of a nuclear weapon anywhere would be a catastrophe for all of humanity. And so we have to remind them of their responsibilities. It's hard to force them, but I think by raising the level of moral norm around the world, putting pressure on them to explain why they are keeping each about 2,500 strategic nuclear weapons on hair trigger alert, meaning that they could be fired on 15 minutes notice, that is uncalled for, and public opinion in the world needs to be gathered to focus on how dangerous the present situation is. It's a danger that is compounded in another area by the emerging terrorism in the world and the possibility of terrorist use of nuclear weapons combined with the keeping nuclear weapons on alert. This double danger, I call it, a double danger to the world is mounting, and it's surprising to me that so many people and members of the public are oblivious to what we're passing through.
Terrorism was a central issue at the 2005 conference. This was the first NPT review since the attacks of 9/11, and the full implications were still being absorbed. As was pointed out at the conference, 9/11 involved an attack on the world's most powerful nuclear weapons nation by an enemy armed only with carpet cutters and plane tickets. Yet against such an enemy, the huge American nuclear arsenal was irrelevant. But the existence of tens of thousands of nuclear weapons and their possible theft or acquisition by terrorist groups compounds the nuclear threat. Terrorist groups have openly announced that they are seeking nuclear weapons. And Osama bin Laden has repeatedly cited the American nuclear bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki as precedents for the use of such weapons against civilian populations.
Nuclear weapons cannot deter. A suicide bomber or an attacker a terrorist armed with a carpet knife who is prepared to give his life for his cause cannot be deterred by any kind of threat, including a nuclear threat. On the contrary, the very existence of nuclear weapons and fissile materials from which to make them leaves the world more vulnerable to attack from non-state actors.
You see, the major they are the ones who are undermining. They say that Iran and North Korea are the threats. I want to make it clear that I believe Iran and North Korea should not obtain nuclear weapons, nor should anybody else. But those two states are the flashpoints off of a volcano. The volcano is the existence of 34,000 nuclear weapons possessed by the nuclear weapon states, most in the hands of the United States and Russia. That's the volcano that is we dare to hope that there will never be an eruption. But who can say that with the spread of nuclear weapons, the proliferation of them into other states, that there will never be a use?
The late astronomer Carl Sagan once commented ruefully that the end result of the age of science has been to booby-trap the planet for destruction. So what to do? The former commander of the American nuclear fleet in the Pacific, Admiral Noel Gyler, once said, "The way to get rid of the bombs is to get rid of the bombs." The Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty is designed as the first necessary step to that end. The NPT has charted the way. The World Court has said nuclear weapons nations must bring to a conclusion agreements to get rid of the bombs, agreements that by UN and international law must be consequent. And practically everyone is calling for nuclear weapons to be taken off hair trigger alert immediately and moved from a time to fire of a few minutes to at least a few days. Experts have told the NPT conference here at the UN that it could be done in less than a week, and international verification would not be a problem. In 1998, the United Kingdom took British nuclear weapons off Cold War hair trigger alert and moved them from a time to fire of a few minutes to several days. The de-alerting was undertaken by order of the United Kingdom Prime Minister Tony Blair without announcement or incident, and has remained in force ever since. And at the Mayor's Conference and at the NGO presentations, as always, the memory and the shadow of Hiroshima haunts.
I think one nuclear weapon is one too much. And our promise is to the people all in the world and to the people of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, no more Hiroshima, no more Nagasaki.
In a presentation to the delegates, a survivor recalled Hiroshima in a declaratory and plaintive reading of the words of one who died.
In the morning of August 6, 1945, I saw the blinding flash of the atomic bomb in Hiroshima. I was 16 years old and standing 4.5 kilometers from ground zero. I watched in awe as the colossal white column rose into the sky. Tens of thousands of mothers and children were shouting and begging in vain to be rescued. By the next morning, the city had been razed to the ground, reduced to a vast nuclear desert. Mr. President, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, please listen to the voices of atomic death from the pen of a deceased poet of Hiroshima, Tōge Sankichi. Our fathers, give them back to me. Our mothers, give them back to me. Our elders, give them back to me. Our children, give them back to me. My humanity, give it back to me. And all humans, link it to me. Peace, give it back to me. One indestructible peace forever, as long as this human world will last. Thank you very much.
And now, more than 60 years after Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the nuclear threat looms over the whole world. With more than 30,000 nuclear weapons in the hands of the leaders of nine nations, the entire planet is now threatened by the nuclear crisis. Kennedy Graham is a UN advisor who helped shape New Zealand's nuclear-free zone policies and created the Planetary Interest Project at Cambridge University in England to develop global approaches to planetary problems.
Even a small, limited nuclear exchange between major powers is likely to degrade the total global biosphere and degrade the quality of human life accordingly. Nuclear weapons are a creation of humanity. They are a product of human ingenuity and human political structure. If they're the product of humanity and governments, they can be resolved by humanity and governments. If you're not going to get initiative of this qualitative kind coming from governments, you're going to require a sea change in the mentality on the part of humans, humanity around the world. That requires initiative on the part of civil society, NGOs.
Hilda Lini of Vanuatu initiated the World Health Organization's call for the World Court ruling on nuclear weapons and now leads the movement for nuclear-free nations and nuclear-free zones.
My own country is a nuclear-free nation. It's the first nuclear-free nation that was declared in 1981, and I believe the first one in the world. That's a government commitment and parliamentary commitment. We have also been able to mobilize provincial governments, and our recent initiative is in mobilizing mayors of the world. And I believe that the leadership that is shown within the civil society against nuclear weapons is becoming stronger every day. And now with the youths and the young people getting on board and taking that leadership role also, that we have the majority of the global population behind the vision for a nuclear weapons-free world, or to do away with nuclear weapons.
And now in another approach, the crisis has been addressed by the Blix Commission as an independent Swedish initiative with members from all continents, with additional support from a Canadian NGO foundation, drawing on earlier studies such as the Australian Canberra Commission and the Japanese Forum on Nuclear Disarmament, citing the World Court and the UN Charter and the work of the Mayors for Peace. The Commission has made its recommendations available to the world.
The Swedish government was ready to pay the major part of the bill, and the rest, or not all, but almost the rest, was paid by the Canadian foundations, Jennifer Simons Foundation in Vancouver. And I think it's good to have these two inputs, a government that is interested in disarmament and a foundation interested in the civic side of the world who is behind it, because not NGOs are an important part of this. We hope to address the three communities, the governmental, the people who deal with disarmament, the think tanks around the world, and the public.
At the NPT review conference, Robert McNamara joined others in condemning the Bush administration for continuing to develop and threatening to test nuclear weapons.
The five-stage of new nuclear weapons, and they will not initiate action to prepare for weapons testing. In contrast to that, the Bush administration has asked Congress to appropriate funds for both of these activities.
A lot of what is happening today in the nuclear area is of concern to me. For example, a number of countries want to get nuclear weapons toward the use of nuclear weapons, military doctrines of several countries. Not only do they accept the possibility of the use of nuclear weapons and another dangerous tendency, the review of instruments, weapons, but even perhaps the preemptive use of those weapons. The most important in combating the arms race, the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty has been frozen. The position of the members of the nuclear club causes concern among many countries, and that concern is, do nuclear powers indeed intend to comply with Article 6? There are also suspicions about certain activities of non-nuclear states, in particular, recently, about Iran and North Korea. We need clarity about what they're doing, but any attempt to solve that problem by using force would have extremely severe consequences.
If there were to be ratification by governments of the CTBT, the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty, including the United States, where
instrument
was turned down in the Senate a number of years ago, then this would change the atmosphere very considerably. We don't see any sign of that during the current administration, and the U.S. is opposed to a ratification. But the reality is probably that if the U.S. were to ratify, then China would. If China did, India would. If India did, Pakistan would. If Pakistan did, then Iran would. So it will set in motion a good domino effect.
The report also warns of the threat of weapons of mass destruction in outer space.
We also deal with outer space, where we fear there is at the present a race going on. It's not simply that there's stagnation in the world of disarmament. There's also a race going on in the outer space weapons. There is one. And also, as when it comes to nuclear weapons, there is a race going on with the U.S. discussions about new types of nuclear weapons, and certainly interest or activity in the same way in other countries.
And the report rejects any assertion that nuclear weapons are a threat only in.
Now, the Commission does not accept that argument. We say that, yes, governments, individuals can be more or less reckless in this world. But the weapons per se are dangerous anywhere, anytime. If you look at the U.S., there are lots of weapons on hair trigger.
In the hands of reckless groups or nations.
Hair trigger alert, and the same applies to Russia. They are dangerous anywhere where they are.
Among the 60 detailed recommendations, explain why and how Russia and the USA should agree on reciprocal steps to take their nuclear weapons off hair trigger alert. Nations should implement fully the terms of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. All nations, including the U.S., should ratify the Comprehensive Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. All nations should abide by the Outer Space Treaty prohibitions on weapons in space. And a special world summit should be convened at the UN to advance these and other proposed recommendations of the Blix Commission, the experts for a world free of weapons of mass destruction. Another veteran of the Cuban Missile Crisis is Theodore Sorensen. As President Kennedy's closest advisor, it was his call for restraint that may have saved the world then, just as he sees hope for change now.
The great thing about democracies is that they are self-correcting. And the leadership at one particular time is not the leadership for the foreseeable future. And with new leadership, I think the United States can lead the way to the fulfillment of Article 6, which is part of the bargain underlying the Non-Proliferation Treaty.
Ted Sorensen is now an advisor to Barack Obama. As the American people prepare to vote for a new president, both major candidates are promising a change of direction. But important differences remain. Republican candidate Senator John McCain calls for steps to reduce nuclear weapons and promises to reconsider the merits of the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty, which he voted against in the Senate. He does not discuss taking nuclear weapons off alert, nor does he discuss the issue of weapons in outer space.
I believe we should reduce our nuclear forces to the lowest level we judge necessary, and we should be prepared to enter into a new arms control agreement with Russia, reflecting the nuclear reductions that I'll seek. I also believe we should work with Russia to build confidence in our missile defense program, including through such initiatives as the sharing of early warning data and prior notification of missile launches. We should work with China to encourage conformity with the practices of the other four nuclear weapon states recognized in the Non-Proliferation Treaty, including working toward nuclear arsenal reductions and toward a moratorium on the production of additional fissile material. I believe we must also address nuclear testing. This would include taking another look at the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty to see what can be done to overcome the shortcomings that prevented it from entering into force. I opposed that treaty in 1999, but I said at the time I would keep an open mind about future developments. I would only support the development of any new type of nuclear weapon that is absolutely essential for the viability of our deterrent, that results in making possible further decreases in the size of our nuclear arsenal, and furthers our global nuclear security goals.
In contrast, Democratic Senator Barack Obama, in a sweeping policy statement, calls for the United States to lead the world in all major disarmament treaties and initiatives toward a weapons-free world.
First, I'll stop spending $9 billion a month in Iraq. I'm the only major candidate who opposed this war from the beginning, and as president, I will end it. Second, I will cut tens of billions of dollars in wasteful spending. I will cut investments in unproven missile defense systems. I will not weaponize space. I will slow our development of future combat systems. And I will institute an independent defense priorities board to ensure that the quadrennial defense review is not used to justify unnecessary spending. Third, I will set a goal of a world without nuclear weapons. To seek that goal, I will not develop new nuclear weapons. I will seek a global ban on the production of fissile material, and I will negotiate with Russia to take our ICBMs off hair trigger alert and to achieve deep cuts in our nuclear arsenals.
Nuclear weapons are not a way to make us secure. They are weapons of terror. We must make absolutely sure that no one, whether it be countries or terrorists, ever uses one again. So we say to diplomats, parliamentarians, and NGOs like GSI, thank you. We're with you. For all of us, you must succeed. That is why I'm here to support this effort and to urge politicians and diplomats everywhere to take heart, to not hesitate or falter. It's my hope that one day the children of the world will be able to look up to us and say, thank you for learning how to get along like grown-ups for our sake. May peace be with you.
Around the world, citizens, state, and local government initiatives are underway. In Europe, the Mayors for Peace will call on the European Parliament to order the irreversible detargeting from nuclear attack of all the world's cities. How effective can mayors be in planetary issues like nuclear disarmament?
I think very effective indeed, and arguably the one new political innovation in terms of process and symbolism that is available to us as humanity, because mayors are increasingly recognized as representing that fulcrum, democratic fulcrum, between the grassroots and global decision making. They are close enough to the people to genuinely represent them, more so than a lot of presidents, I have to say.
In Australia, Gareth Evans, who represented the country at the World Court hearings on the bomb, has now been appointed by the Rudd government to co-chair a new international commission on nuclear disarmament and abolition. In Italy, citizens groups have called on the national parliament to officially declare the entire nation of Italy to be a nuclear-free zone. And the mayor of Milan offered a chilling statistic at the United Nations.
Apparently there is one ton of TNT equivalent warheads on alert for each inhabitant of the planet.
Norway became the first country to divest from their huge government pension funds, the third largest in the world, all investments in companies that make nuclear bombs. They named some of the world's largest corporations: BAE, Boeing, Northrop Grumman, Honeywell, Finmeccanica, Safran, and United Technologies. Around the world, other governments and at local level, city mayors are considering similar action. Also in Norway, the government is building two nuclear power plants running on thorium rather than uranium or plutonium. Thorium is not suitable for nuclear weapons. It does not melt down or blow up, and existing power plants can be retrofitted to run on thorium. It is not a perfect or long-term solution. It produces radioactive waste, much less than existing plants, but thorium wastes can still last 500 years. But that is a mere blink of the eye compared to the already existing uranium and plutonium wastes, mainly from making bombs, some of which will remain lethally radioactive for tens of millions of years.
What are the consequences if we fail? If we fail sooner or later and these nuclear weapons stick around, we're going to blow ourselves up. Or alternatively, don't move to clean, renewable energy sources, if we don't start saving the environment, if we don't get serious about family planning and stabilize the population of human beings, well, I can tell you, we're in real big trouble. I mean, I think there's a reasonable chance that the human race will be extinct in 50 years. On the other hand, if we make the right choices and implement the right programs, all of which we know what they are, they've all been discussed here today, if we do that, there's no reason why we couldn't live for an indefinite amount of period of time on this beautiful planet for another few million years. And I personally think that's the better way to go, because I think we're pretty terrific, you know?
We must cure the current system, which is so seriously ill that a few dozen aggressive and competitive men have the power to destroy all life on Earth. the prescription for this illness is a system that reflects the majority opinion of the world faithfully. Mayors for Peace will not rest until people everywhere are awakened and are pouring their energy into creating channels through which our opinion, the opinion of the majority of the world, can determine the future of humankind. The struggle against nuclear weapons is a fight we can win and must win. So let's just win it.
A recent poll by Associated Press showed that 66% of Americans understand that they were given four choices. One is just the U.S. should have nuclear weapons. And you can imagine George Bush saying, yeah, that sounds good. Just the U.S. and its friends should have nuclear weapons. Well, Pakistan's a friend, but I'm not sure how great that is. The other proposal was just those who have them now, well, we could sort of freeze it like that and it'll be beautiful. And the third choice was nobody should have them. 66% of the people did the logical, sensible, and fair thing and said nobody should have it, including the United States. That was in the question. So I think that this crowd can be confident that they're really speaking on behalf of the majority of Americans and the vast majority of people in the world.
We have to move to a stage where national sovereignty does not mean that you have the right to own nuclear weapons, that we have international ownership, international control, and international verification, where nuclear weapons have dwindled to either one or zero, de-alerted.
And now with the youths and the young people getting on board and taking that leadership role also, that we have the majority of the global population behind the vision for a nuclear weapons free world.
In a document that was adopted and signed by me and President Reagan, that a nuclear war cannot be won and must never be fought.
I feel that my country bears an enormous responsibility to change the course of how nuclear weapons are treated.
I believe we should reduce our nuclear forces to the lowest level we judge necessary, and we should be prepared to enter into a new arms control agreement with Russia, reflecting the nuclear reductions that I'll seek.
I will set a goal of a world without nuclear weapons. To seek that goal, I will not develop new nuclear weapons. I will seek a global ban on the production of fissile material, and I will negotiate with Russia to take our ICBMs off hair trigger alert.
The struggle against nuclear weapons is a fight we can win and must win. So let's just win it.
Become a real danger to the continued existence of the human species. And this is the reason why our immediate objective is the elimination of nuclear weapons.